is that why black and ethnic minority representation is important for the left and progressive politics. It's not that it shows you're nice people. It's not that you're doing anybody any favours. It's that your progressive politics will be so much stronger if you are engaged with and involving BAME communities. It's one of Jeremy's strengths as a leader and in the general election that he has had so much support from BAME communities. And that's because they know, even when Jeremy wasn't getting the attention he gets in the mainstream media, that he's always been a supporter of racial justice, and he's always supported issues in relation to BAME communities. And in fact, I think I first met Jeremy, he was actually with Bernie Grant, because they were both hanging counties at the time. And Jeremy's record on race and equality goes back over 30 years. But the other thing to say is we've made some progress on black ethnic minority representation. It's a fact that Jeremy Corbyn has more BAME women, men and women in his cabinet, in his shadow cabinet, than any other Labour leader. He currently has 4 BAME women. We have more BAME MPs in the Labour Party than ever before. And it's quite important to say that. Some people take the number of BAME MPs for granted, and there is some way to go, particularly when it represents in reference to BAME male representation. But nonetheless, it is the Labour Party that's shown the way, and other parties that have followed. Tories were forced to scramble and get more BAME candidates because we had done so. The Lib Dems, sadly, not anything we could do could persuade them to have more BAME candidates. But there you go. So there has been progress, but there are some lessons we have to relearn as BAME activists about solidarity, about supporting each other, and about having a genuine ideological base for our politics. It can't just be about, I want to be councillor, I want to be an MP. Labour has been and is a champion of BAME communities. We were running BAME people for Parliament years before the Tory party, the Lib Dems, had ever thought of it. There was a man called David Pitt. He was one of the first black people to run for Parliament. He wasn't able to get in, actually, because of the rest of the electorate at that point. He went to the House of Lords, but he was a real pioneer, David Pitt. He was from the Grenadier of West Indies. And I remember when I first entered Parliament 30 years ago, one of the people that was there to greet me was Lord Pitt. So we've been a champion of BAME communities, and at the general election, Labour's share of the BAME vote rose by 6 points compared to 2015, and we took 73% of the BAME vote, whereas the Conservative vote amongst BAME voters fell by 4 points on the previous general election, which I think shows how shrewd BAME voters are. But it's important, as I say, one of the things that I'm wary of is black ethnic minority representation in general, which is just about representation. So it's important to spell out some of the realities for BAME communities. Poverty is twice as likely amongst ethnic minorities as it is for white people, and the number of long-term unemployed young people in BAME communities has almost doubled in recent years. And it's worth pointing out that the collapse of the sort of skilled blue-collar employment that people of my parents' generation, Kingsley's parents' generation, took for granted as a way that black families earned a living and were able to support each other has collapsed. BAME, British people, have, I think, been particularly affected by the collapse in manufacturing. People forget, younger ones are much sure forget. An era where London had a lot of light engineering, it had a lot of manufacturing activity in areas like Queen's Park, in Brent, and in Tottenham, factories in Tottenham, and that has all collapsed to the detriment, I think, of the economic status of the BAME community. Young BAME people face an astonishing 50% rise in long-term unemployment since the Tories were first elected in 2000. And let me tell you, you may see now the old BAME Tory MP, but the reality of what Tory policies mean for BAME communities is really quite dire. This is why I keep coming back to the fact we cannot just focus on representation to the exclusion of all else. And you know, they always used to say, oh, you know, black young people, they need to go out there and get an education and so on. Well, they have gone out there and got an education. But the fact is, BAME graduates face higher unemployment than their white counterparts, and on average, earn 23% less even when working. And there's all sorts of research that's been done which demonstrates that if you have an ethnic minority or non-Anglo-Saxon name, you will find it harder to get shortlisted for certain jobs, including the medical profession, and you will find it harder to get recruited. So there is still institutional racism in employment. African-Caribbean and Asian workers are more than twice as likely to be in low-paid and insecure work. And people talk a lot about zero-hours contracts. Who do you think disproportionately has zero-hour contracts? Black, Asian, and minority ethnic workers. So I think it's important to base our politics in the economic realities and the social realities for black and minority ethnic communities. So what is the way forward? One of the ways forward, in my view, is something that some of us have been talking about for 30 years, and that is to introduce all black and minority ethnic shortlists to parliamentary selection. Based discrimination, which is thing I referred to earlier, and consider rolling out name-blind recruitment practices if necessary. We want to boost the income of black and Asian minority communities by introducing a real living wage of £10 per hour, £10 an hour by 2020, and enforcing it. The number of prosecutions for not paying the minimum wage is derisory. We need to take robust action against violence and hate crime. We need to review the PREVENT programme, I'm sure you can hear more about that later. And we need to look at issues around black people and mental health. Black people, particularly young black men, are disproportionately represented in our mental health systems, and we need to develop a strategy to deal with the inequalities in mental health and to raise the carers' allowance, to recognise the contribution of unpaid carers. We need to reintroduce the education maintenance allowance, because you know, in ACME, my young people, everyone was going on about tuition fees, but actually doing away with the education maintenance allowance was a bigger blow for working class young people, and in particular working class black and Asian people. And we need to work to eliminate the institutional biases and the use of stop and search powers, and we need to actually deliver genuine policing by consent. So in closing, I know the chair's anxious for this close. In closing, it's not about dealing with community leaders. It's not about just remembering you've got a BAME community at election time. It's about genuinely engaging with your community around the issues that they are concerned about. It's about learning about the work and research into issues ranging from education to policing. I mean, Cecile, our chair, has done some very important work around education. It's about engaging with that work because, as I said, it's not about you being nicer people. It is about us being a stronger left and a transformative left. Thank you very much.
Did not fear engaging with black minority ethnic communities, but naturally engaged and delivered on the issues that matter to us, and matter to us as Black and minority ethnic communities, up and down, and he's been doing that for years. It wasn't an overnight transformation. And as somebody who has long campaigned on issues of race, I took that responsibility very seriously. And it pains me. It pains me when I see that we have more Black young people in our prisons and mental institutions than we do in our universities. Because that reminds me of the subjugation and exploitation and political oppression, really, and economic exploitation and derogation of our communities. And that should never, ever be forgotten. That's why we need a transformational set of politics, not a transition. We need a transformational set of politics based on clear Labour socialist values, because that's, and it needs to be from the ground up. So this isn't about creating the policies that just gets us into government. This is about creating the policies that last and sustains itself no matter who is in government. And because that's the level of transformation that is required. The policies that we set now must last generations, i.e. it should never be possible to ever return us back into privatisation of our public railways after we have put them back into public control when we take power. We make those transformations so that they last. I have a role at a local government board. I'm an elected councillor. I'm an elected councillor in the London Borough of Islington, and I have a role delivering on environment and transport issues. And I take that responsibility seriously, because to me, tackling environment and energy issues, for example, means that we're not only tackling climate change, but we are tackling fuel poverty, and we are tackling poverty at the heart of our communities. What is happening with our communities, which are where we are disproportionately overrepresented in the poverty field as Black and minority ethnic communities, also affects us in terms of climate change. When we see the decisions that we make here as local government, as governments, the decisions that we make here affect our communities globally. We can only but see what's happened in terms of the hurricanes in the Caribbean, the tragedies in Mexico, the effects of climate change. And we have a responsibility that when we do take power, we use that responsibility wisely. So when, as local authorities, we're making decisions about what to cut in times of austerity, we have to remember the global impact of those decisions. So when local authorities, as they have done, have cut their climate change officers or their fuel poverty officers, what happens is you get no action at local government level here. And then what happens is, globally, our communities are suffering. When our communities are suffering, as recently in the Caribbean, it means that when you're trying to engage Black and minority ethnic communities in the politics of the day, they are worried about what's happening in the communities globally. And when you've got Caribbean countries that are now being devastated by the acts of hurricanes and so on, what it means is those countries globally that have stopped farming long ago because of the global interactions of places like the US that have convinced them somehow that they don't need to farm, that what they should do instead is buy US products, open US supermarkets, and then what they're left with is tourism to rely on. And then you have a hurricane, then what? There's no land, there's no farming, there's no nothing else going on. So now we have to spend time, supporting our communities abroad, globally because of the actions here. And then we have to campaign hard to remind this government and other Western governments that the reason why that we are there is because of the actions of countries like Britain in the colonisation of those countries. And they don't have a responsibility just to those countries that remain dependent on the UK, but they have a responsibility to former colonies as well. So we have to remind them. Now, that they're going to arrive 3 weeks later is not good enough. And we have to remind them that their response is not good enough. Because equally, we remind them of why immigration is important and why refugees migrants are important. We remind them of the Western intervention in countries abroad have created the conditions that have meant that people have had to flee their homes because of the Western activities, the selling of arms to corrupt governments. We have to remind them of their responsibility. Equally, in the UK, we have to remind ourselves of our responsibilities to black and minority ethnic communities here. And people will know that I played a role in trying to get the Metropolitan Police Service to change its policy on how it dealt with the criminalisation, not only the criminalisation of our communities, but how it dealt with the devastating impact of gun crime that disproportionately was affecting our black communities. And in particular, how it was enabling almost 100% of fatalities on the streets of London when it came to gun crime. And it was only the case of Jill Dando, actually, if people remember that far back, that we got any attention on the issue of gun crime. But actually, when Jill Dando died in the horrific way that she died, gunned down on the streets of London, shot dead in the head, well, actually, 90% of gun fatalities in London were of black men. But the media paid no attention. The police took no action. And therefore, it was the responsibility of us as communities to say enough is enough. Yes, we're taking heed. The police are giving us heed in terms of the disproportionate criminalisation of our communities. But equally, we need them to take action to protect our communities, not go abroad as they did, not go as broad as they did, and bring in what we would call criminal informants, place them in our communities, give them a home, and that was their response to the gun crime in London. That's why it was important that we spent that time trying to transform the way of working of the police so that they saw black and minority ethnic communities as victims of crimes and not see them purely as criminals. So this kind of transformation needs to happen not just in those kinds of institutions, but politically as well. Because as this general election showed, that the ideology and propaganda of the past, the way in which the Labour Party operated, it said, when we go out and knock on doors, we knock on these particular doors of the people that are likely to vote for us. And you know the people that we didn't knock on were black minority ethnic doors. I didn't quite understand it. But that was the propaganda of the party because we said that they didn't come out and vote. But what this general election showed us, that if you give people something to vote for, of course they will come up out and vote. And you can't write off black young men get them out to vote. You cannot write off homeless people. You cannot write off people living in poverty. We have a duty and a responsibility. That change not only needs to come from the leadership of the party, that change actually also needs to come from the grassroots in our wards, in our CLPs as well. Because it always is a bitter shame to me to to know that I'm in an inner city borough in Islington. And when I first rocked up at RGC, I could not believe that I was the only black face in that room. And it has taken me many, many years later, to even get an increase in the kinds of representation in an inner city London borough. This cannot be the way. We must all look around our wards, all look around our GCs, all look around our CLPs and say, where is the representation? Jeremy Corbyn is showing leadership. We need to replicate that leadership on the ground. We need to reach out, not say, not write people off as not being engaged. And actually, you need to make our systems on the ground more exciting, more engaging, and more involving. Let's concentrate on issues that matter. I'm delighted to sit as we did with Diane Abbott. I'm delighted the conference today gave her not just one standing ovation, but several standing ovations. It is a disgrace that as a black woman, we have to witness the level of abuse that our hero gets. We stand the team to face abuse. We should all be angry. We should all be angry. It's just unacceptable. Thank you.
To have a responsibility to ensure that we have a thriving youth section in every constituency in this country. You don't have to be female to ensure that at least half our elected representatives are female, and you don't have to be black or minority ethnic to have the responsibility to ensure that we have an organisation in the Labour Party that can both represent and reach out and engage black people and minority ethnic people in our party and our communities. And actually, I would argue that the left has had a good record on the whole, certainly in recent decades. The campaign for Labour Party Democracy, which I was involved in alongside other people in this room in the late 1970s and early 1980s, pioneered argued for the end of all male shortlists and argued for the inclusion of women on shortlists, and that is what led eventually to all women shortlists and to the transformation, not quite far enough yet, but the transformation of the Parliamentary Labour Party on that issue. The campaign for Labour Party Democracy also backed fully the black sections movement in the 1980s. I'm here to underline the fact that momentum puts equalities, and in particular the representation of black people in the party, at the forefront of its campaign. So I also want to pay tribute to another bit of an achievement of the left. I want to also remember the role played by Ken Livingstone and the Greater London Council in the 1980s. Seriously, Ken was vilified for that, but actually the work he did made it possible for the Labour government that followed it with a different political complexion to achieve what it did. Now, we've got a policy review in this party, and that is an opportunity to make big changes. But what are the changes that we need to make in black representation? We, in the course of the discussions about this event in this policy review, were raising a number of issues. And then we came to the election that took place recently within BAME Labour. and some of our activists, Becky on this platform, and others were involved in putting together a slate for that election. And we were extremely disappointed to find the numbers of people who, even if they got letters telling them, inviting them to make nominations, ended up not getting ballot papers. The number of people who had tried to join Black Labour who nevertheless found that they were disenfranchised. And when we eventually, after rather a long time after the result was made known, we discovered that actually there were only 731 ballot papers issued in that election. I think everybody was deeply shocked that an organisation that has existed now for many, many years, actually, albeit it was an organisation that was designed not so much to represent black people as to end the campaign for black sections in the Labour Party, we were shocked to discover that the organisation was, by virtue of its tiny size, actually not really fit for purpose to represent black people in this party. And so I hope that we will see out of this review a BAME organisation within the Labour Party which really can involve all BAME members of the Labour Party. That it can do that without them having to pay additional membership fees. That it can have a really effective representation on the national executive, on a regional level in the party, that we will have vibrant BAME forums at constituency level, that we have BAME conferences at a national level and a regional level. Now that's what, you know, that's what momentum I hope will be pressing for during the course of this review, and we will hope and we will organise for that to happen in the future.
Which really was not a lot. The constitution itself is public, but there was no information, for example, on the number of members on the finances, no meetings from any of the executive committee meetings. There was really very little information, even as to who the committee members were, because there were extra committee members that had just been co-opted on, who knows how, where, why, when, what is going on there. So even though we were working with an insider on the committee, we couldn't get the answers to any of these questions that we were asking. And then came the elections, and people we know who were eligible to participate in the elections were kicked out for no reason. People who we know weren't eligible to participate in the elections were able to participate. And some people weren't allowed to vote, and other people were, and you know, the whole thing was such a mess. And it ended up essentially with us asking the question of, well, what do we do with this organisation? Okay, so essentially BAME Labour, what it is, it's an affiliated socialist society. Okay, but because it came up through black sections, which a lot of people here were kind of building, it evolved in quite an erratic fashion. Okay, so it started off as a socialist, it's now a socialist society which is affiliated to the Labour Party, but it also has a seat on the NEC, so it has kind of a lot of power that's kind of come down through this grassroots organisation, but there is no grassroots organisation anymore. You know, there's nothing that we can draw on. There's no networks, no big networks, but no big national networks that are connected up. That's what BAME Labour is supposed to be, and it's just not. It's designed to divide the BAME membership within the party. Now, we have a party of nearly 600,000 members. You're telling me that there's only 720 BAME members who are eligible to decide who represents us in the top governing body of the Labour Party? No, it doesn't work like that. Okay, and it's been designed to be that way, so it's very easy to kind of manipulate and create this culture of secrecy, of shrouded darkness. We don't know what's going on there. We're not supposed to know what's going on there. When we ask the questions, we get pushed aside. It's not for us. So, but the thing is, with the advent of Corbynism, with all of the new manifesto, everything that people have been talking about here that's really infused people, that have really brought people back to the Labour Party and said, you know what, that is a party that should be talking to me, that is starting to talk to me. Where's my voice in it? So we now have a lot more black being people who are coming into this organisation, who are enthused and wanting to organise so they get the sorts of policies and the sort of party and the sort of society that they want to be. So it's really an opportunity for us. You know, I think there's a reason why we started questioning about BAME Labour like when we did, and why there's a lot. I mean, it's really interesting now because this whole ethos of where the Labour Party is going is giving the voice back to the membership. You know, we've got double the delegates here that we did last year. You know, we've got arguments being said for like lay members to be discussing and democratising the Labour Party, and we have to be having that discussion for BAME Labour as well. It cannot be left behind at this time, and I think that there is now a lot of enthusiasm and a lot of people who are really kind of coming together, and that's an opportunity to organise for these things. And as John said, I think there's a lot of push for broadening out what BAME Labour is, which is essentially an organisation to represent and speak for like BAME Labour Party members, so we have to make sure that it includes everyone. So we've got to be kind of really raising our voices, coming together, organising and pushing for these sorts of things, and only then will it be given to us. It won't be handed to us. We have to do that ourselves. We all have to come together and organise. So that's what we've been pushing to do, and hopefully there'll be lots more opportunity to kind of like hear from the floor and hear your ideas for that, because we've got loads of ideas and it's really good to like get that started.
People who just left, can you come back? it's always difficult to go last, isn't it? So what I wanted to do is just to whiz through a few issues, because first of all, my name is Kingsley Abrams. I'm the General Secretary of Momentum Black Caucus. I sit on a body of United Left, which is a left group within Unite. I sit on that executive committee of United Left. And you notice when people mentioned black sections earlier this evening, the 10th term to me, I've said black sections because I used to be the general secretary of black sections in the Labour Party. Yes, I do feel a bit old with this new politics going on in Labour. So for me, the transformation agenda is about power. It's about how we gain power and how we keep power.
And when I speak at audiences like this, and people who've only just joined the Labour Party, and they don't know how lucky they are, they actually have got a left leader of the Labour Party. Who've had Blair and Brown and Mary Lyon and all that stuff in the 80s and the 90s and 2000, you've got a left leader of the Labour Party, and you've got someone who can actually be Prime Minister on the left at the next general election, unless something goes dramatically wrong. The next Prime Minister of the United Kingdom will be a left Corbynista called Jeremy Corbyn. I want to. Therefore, how do we do what I call institutionalized Corbynism? I don't want to wake up in the next 5 or 10 years and Caroline Flynn is leader of the Labour. Yes? You know, and Tom Watson is sort of weasel his way into somewhere on the NEC or something or the other. Yes? So, that's why I like this audience, because you need to go back and think about how we institutionalize Corbynism. How we gain power and we keep it for years and years and years. And in doing so, not gaining power for the sake of it, but also for gaining power to change the society. And if we change that society, then the black community and the black society will be transformed as well. So I don't look at this discussion in isolation. Therefore, we need the 5%. We need to get a situation whereby we'll need 5% of MPs to get a left leader on the ballot paper, a left candidate on the ballot paper, if and when Jeremy Corbyn stands down for the future. Because it has to be about after Corbyn as well, if you are going to sort of institutionalise Corbynism. We go for those extra seats on the NEC. We've had 600,000 members of the party, so we need more seats. But in that power game, how many of those seats are going to be black? I want to have that conversation with you as well. Because not all of those new seats, three in the CLPs, one in the union, all should be white party members. We need obviously to have a Corbynist elected as the leader of Scottish Labour. That's the context of the transformation agenda. And we need to have a discussion at some point as to who and what follows Corbyn. And how do we get a left sustainable leadership? Not a left leadership today, gone tomorrow, but a left sustainable leadership. And the black struggle is within that context as well. And that brings me on to my good friend Keith Vaz, and why it's so important that we tackle BAME Labour and remove Keith Vaz from the NEC. I said right at the beginning, I said Vaz will not vote for Corbyn, get him off the NEC. I said, oh, give him some time, maybe he'll come round, maybe he'll... No, we've got to get him off the NEC. When we were in the Black Social Society negotiating with the Labour Party that we'll have a BAME seat on the NEC, for us to have that seat, they need to have 2,500 black members of the Labour Party in BAME Labour. And as John mentioned and others have mentioned, there's 731 members. All the members have been recruited since Corbyn became leader. This BAME Labour could only have 731. Of which only 500 voted in the last election to elect Keith Vaz. And then he goes back and he votes against Corbyn on the NEC. So that's our first task, that we get rid of Vaz. So the next election, so we have to get black people joining BAME Labour so that we can actually take on Vaz at the next election to remove him. Now the Labour Party has targeted 75 marginals for the next election. How many of you know that there are 75 marginal seats that Labour will be targeting in the next election? How many people know the process has already started to select those seats? July, August, the process started. How many people know when the process will end? November, the process will end. And there we come to it. Now, how many black people in the Labour Party knows the process even exists?
One.
Yes? So all these 75 seats, we can't have them all having white candidates only. So they've got to be black candidates. election in Wimbledon, which is on the list. A black person comes and says, I want to be a candidate in Wimbledon. Yeah, but where have you been for the last 8 months? Do you know where the place is? Have you got your CV ready? Have you done momentum training? Have you done the app? And all that stuff. Yes? So we want to make sure that they're properly trained so they can take on marginal seats. Because we didn't do too badly last time. We've got Marsha in Battersea. Right? I submitted as the General Secretary of Black Momentum Black Caucus. I wasn't too sure we'll make it. It was a 7,000 Tory majority. We were trying to get Marsha in one of the lowership seats. And then she got back to see and thought, oh my God, how are we going to take on 7,000? But Momentum had a strategy to take on seats up to 7,000. And they got into it. And Marsh is going to get in. But the other thing I want to mention as well, when we come to things like that, the next election, we need to target seats properly, much better. So why have Tooting with a 31,000 majority? Oh, it's a wonderful Tooting MP. Nothing against the MP. But the majority is 31. And yet we lose Putney by 1,005. It don't make sense. So the next time around we need to target seats properly so that we can take Putney and seats like that. So we want to see the unions doing more. The unions need to do more to support black candidates. Momentum Office and its leadership and its NCG needs to do more to make sure that black candidates get into some of these winnable seats. And we want to see the leaders' office doing a bit more to ensure. Out of those 75, how much should we ask for as black members within the movement? 5, 6? And we'll struggle. So we'll need some help to get more black representation. Just quickly, on the manifesto and the policies. But it's not just about, I don't support people just because they're black. I've never done that in the past, and I don't intend to do that in the future. You've got to be on the left. You've got to be called minister. And at least I'm never going to be government. And Brexit. Well, racism is driving Brexit. So we've got to take on these issues and tackle it. There's a lot of people who voted Brexit and felt that the next day black people will then leave. Yes? So it's serious, it's important because racism has gone up with Brexit. Yes, of course, we need an immigration system that is properly managed. But we need a fair managed immigration and migration system. We don't need a Europe. We don't need a Europe that allows its people to die in the sea. That's the problem. I remain a black European. I remain a black European. I voted for women. So I want to see us defend and expand through the movement. I'm not happy with the common drift that's going at the moment on this issue. But I support freedom because we want to see it expand. Some of the issues we need to tackle. Grenfell. The disgrace of Grenfell. Yeah. So you pack the tower with migrants and poor people, and then you run it down. You can't even give it sprinkler so that if there's a fire, that you'll be able to tackle the fire. So all that nonsense we need to stop. And of course, that's driven by austerity. And once again, those of you who only recently joined, you not only have a left leader of a party, you have an anti-austerity leader and chancellor of your party. Can you imagine? Yeah? Remember Ed Balls? How do we cut this slower than the Tories? Yeah, or whatever. But you actually got an anti-austerity leadership and party. So we need an end to austerity. We need. Momentum Black Caucus will be working with the Black MPs to launch in the months to come. But we can actually say to you, which many people haven't been able to say, go home and prepare for government. Thank you.
Thank you, Kingsley. Okay, floor's open to you. Questions? There with the blue jumper. Throw me mine.
Pants in front.
So. Did you say?
Roger Gillett.
Secretary, Chief of the Book for Brain, now a marginal seat. We were hoping to have a black and ethnic minority man an Asian man who started off with 12,000 against Ian Duncan Smith, brought it down to 7,000, this time brought it down to 2,500. We are now an all-woman shortlist. I think that was an unfortunate decision. I support all women shortlists, but I also think we should deal with the fact that we had a really good black candidate who should have not done all women shortlisted. Chief of the Group for Green. Secondly, as a membership secretary, many of the points that have been made here occur because of the way the membership system works. I download a spreadsheet from the National Labour Party system, and it has a column for male or female, has a column for disabled. A long time ago, about 6 years ago now, I wrote to the head of the service for membership and said, we should have a column for ethnic minority. I was told it wasn't possible. Have you ever heard of such nonsense? If you do manage to get the information about a self-declared ethnic minority out of the Labour Party system, which you can't do in that report, which is the standard report, but you can pull out some information, so few people who are black have actually self-nominated that the number would still be tiny in proportion to the real number of black members in your party. That's our party. We are at fault, this needs fixing, and it needs this organisation and Momentum and MPs like Diane and others to get the officers to change the way the party code works.
Changes in the Labour Party. Rule changes is something that needs to be done. I've got real changes in terms of voting rights, because I'm on the committee now, but I can speak, but I can't vote. What is the point of having a voice if we can't have a real influence and change? So we need to have that done. So that's what. And also ethic monitoring, it needs to be changed, but that stops us being independent.
Okay, thank you very much for that. So I'll put those three questions to the panel. Just to remind the panel, the first question related to a hierarchy of oppression. So we need all women shortlist versus BAME candidates. The need to have reparation as a policy agenda. And the final one, rule change. Claudia, let's have a go at.
I guess I always find it difficult to respond to the question that always talks about women versus minority ethnic. You can see my dilemma. the reality is we've got these target seats. We have wanted to ensure that, one, unlike what we did in the general election, that the selection of candidates is done by the party themselves, i.e. on the ground by the COP themselves. So that's why we're on an election footing. Jeremy's put us on election footing. That's right. We could have a next general election anytime soon. We have to be ready. To be ready, we've identified our target seats, and we're saying that under our current rules, we want more women in Parliament. We have to balance the situation as it is now. We're on a democratic deficit when it comes to women. That's why 69% of the target seats that we've identified are now AWS. Hotly contested between the different constituent elements of the Labour Party. Historically defined from our own formation. That's why the unions have a great say. Of course, the leader's office has a great say, and others, socialist groups and others, have a great say. We've come to a decision as an NEC, and very clearly, there will be some men who stood, as in the general election, that will not be able to stand again in those seats because they're now AWS seats. And of course, there are people that will argue that some of those seats were seats that were contested by BAME men. In reality, we know that they were seats that were contested by minority ethnic men, because we know equally that black men, African Caribbean men, have complained. They said we weren't represented or reflected in any increase in seats. So this issue of race is dynamic. And I have always have difficulties speaking about the issue of race as it's applicable in our diversity to an audience that may not fully understand the different dynamics of it. Because I, you see, come historically, I was born in Leicester, and I grew up historically in a city that defined itself as a black, regardless of your minority ethnic position. Ugandan Asians told me they were black. We're all black in this society because of racism. But we have a situation now where black sections was significant. But we're now called BAME, Black, Asian, and Minority Ethnic. It's a dynamic which is difficult. As equally as difficult as black women, black minority ethnic women, saying that we too want representation as women and as black people. And it's a one that we constantly contest at one level. We know, because Diane Abbott has said it, and it's true, that we haven't had our fair share of representation even when we've had all women shortlist. All women shortlist have returned essentially white women. And essentially what that has meant was there was a democratic deficit in terms of black minority ethnic women. Well, you know what Jeremy Corbyn did? Well, you see it every day. We have the largest number of black women reflected in the shadow cabinet. And we have to be proud of that.
Okay, Claudia, but the issue is, these things are always difficult, and they are a challenge, but it can't be beyond the Labour Party.
It's not beyond the Labour Party. We've got a review right now. We have a review right now. And in terms of the NEC, we have a review right now, the Corbyn review is what I'm going to call it.
Okay.
That would give us root and branch opportunity to look at root and branch of the Labour Party.
Okay.
I will sit as part on that panel on that review. And we have to make our representation. Diane Abbott has already said today that what we need to do is try to return and have all black, the arguments about all black shortlists. And I think that in areas where there are black majority cities, like Leicester, that we ought to have consider black shortlists. That isn't beyond our thinking. But we have to have that debate equally amongst black and minority ethnic members of the party. I have difficulties when I come to an event to discuss with black and minority ethnic members of the party, and we aren't really reflected even here.
No.
So we need to invite our black and minority ethnic members and have a debate with ourselves, and then we need to share what our decision is.
On the first question, I don't think we should get into the debate about women versus black people. And I say this from when I was the Black Section's General Secretary. We were one of the first groups on the left in the 80s and 90s that pushed for all women shortlists. And I still retain that position. So the party's right to have all women shortlists. But as Claudia's just said, all women shortlists and black women has not been reflected in those elections, and they haven't come through all women shortlists. In terms of BAME, Labour, and Lewisham, I think it's about time there's at least one black MP in BAME and Lewisham. We can work with that with colleagues in Lewisham for the future. To come and where there are problems with BAME Forum, we need to tackle that as well. Reparation, yes, I support that, so that the Labour and Grant and others.
I just wanted to make a quick point that I think the entire panel is about representation, but we have to be talking about the wider issues of engagement as well. And I think that it's really important that while we're talking about getting representation, and it's fantastic that we are so diverse at the top, right the way up to the cabinet right now, we have to really be talking about how we get there. And it's not just about pushing people through. I support all women's shortlists. I think all BAME shortlists in many areas is a very good idea, but I think it's not the answer. The answer is empowering and engaging with BAME people to make sure that we claim our voice in the Labour Party. It's our party. It speaks for us. So let's that's how we achieve that. That's what we should be working towards.
So we may respond to that, but there was a specific question directed at Momentum in terms of reparation on the agenda.
Okay. Yeah. First of all, on the question of reparations in respect to slavery, I mean the situation I think is even worse than. Rather suggest, because actually, as I understand it, the abolition of slavery resulted in the biggest compensation scheme of all time in Britain, but not for slaves, but for slave owners,
exactly.
Including David Cameron. So actually, it's a matter of redistribution of compensation, rather than as well as actual compensation. So I strongly sympathise and support what was said. I think in terms of hierarchies, I support what Kingsley said. I think also it's worth remembering that actually at the time that that section started, you know, we weren't just dealing with the problem of the lack of positive action. We were dealing with overt discrimination against black candidates. We were dealing with black candidates who were vetoed on the grounds that they were black, standing in by-elections in Peckham. You know, Martha Ottingham, you know, Sharon Atkin. You know, it was outrageous what we did. We are actually a few steps forward, but we have further to go. I think in terms of the rule changes in relation to what constituency parties, so that is included in the review. You know, the review is going to look at the structure of constituency parties. There are lots of issues to deal with in constituency parties that go beyond the subject of discussion here, but it absolutely includes, you know, we should have active black and minority ethnic forums in constituency parties wherever there is a significant BAME population. We should have BAME officers, and this is something that the review will deal with, and I think we're very lucky to have Claudia who's going to be involved in that review.
Which gentleman?
The hair.
Two
women, please.
Hello, mine's
quite loud, isn't it?
Yes.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
My name's Tassib Morville from North Warwickshire, member of Momentum of the Labour Party. I think the transformative agenda has already started with the good work that John Lansman has done with Momentum. And we've been able to achieve fantastic results with that. The Labour Party is actually changing in a way which is conducive to the masses and not the few, i.e. progress. What I would like to say is that Momentum needs to continue that energy in terms of what Kingsley has said to support BAME candidates in the 75 seats that have been designated to be filled by November. Not just that, we need an improvement in councillor selection and all that sort of stuff. And what Becky has said, I think is absolutely key. We've got to start engagement. We've got to stop going to the godfathers and community leaders who actually just represent themselves. And we've got to engage with the masses. I think Momentum is doing that as a whole. So we need to make that a priority. And just one last thing. We have BAME people on the NCG. I also believe that we need to have a reflection in the workforce who are also BAME. And resources need to be allocated for the BAME people to be able to do what the BAME agenda needs to do.
Hello, my name is Lucy Scott. I've recently joined the Labour Party because I have felt that the time is right. I have signed up to Momentum as well. I have to say though, that as someone that falls into the category of BAME, I was asked my information. I freely gave up my ethnicity and my personal information. I was quite surprised that that wasn't then channeled into some mailing list that would automatically give me information that would relate to issues relating to myself and things that I may well be passionate and motivated by. I have to say that I found out about my ethnic minority forum just incidentally because it was tagged onto the bottom of an email that was sent out inviting people to a fundraising barbecue in a different part of my constituency. I did go along to that and I did take up an officer's post, but again, it's quite dismaying to find out that there isn't a centralised mailing list. There's no real way of contacting and finding out who the BAME members are. That starts with the ward. And the suggestion that I came up with is that when you ask people to divulge their personal information about their ethnicity, I think that in light of the change in the Data Protection Act, it would be a good idea to give a box at the bottom where people are able to tick to say, yes, I would like myself to be put onto a mailing list relating to black, Asian and minority ethnic issues. Also, I did join Momentum. I'm here as a volunteer because I wanted to, you know, actually be part of that physical Momentum movement. But today is the first time I'm hearing about the Black Caucus movement within Momentum. So me personally, I'm really disappointed that I have had to make that effort to find out about it. I will come and talk, and I do want to be involved. So I just wanted to express that. So with the people doing the review, my suggestion was include a tick box, give people the option, do they want to be put on that mailing list? So at the end of the ethnic minority form, you've got an option whether or not you want to be on the mailing list. My question is, reparations was mentioned, institutionalized racism has been mentioned. I feel that we slipped on that path towards progress. So my question is, what is the party's intention in relation to universities educating prospective teachers, nurses, midwives, doctors, whoever, to be more worldly and wise about the actual reality of what has built inequality structurally into our society?
Thank you very much. I was very encouraged to hear what you're saying about the state of the BAME groups. My name is Gloria Lugeros. I am a Latino woman. I'm a British Latino. And I have been involved in anti-racist politics for years, both here and in South America. I'm a member of the BAME Forum in Brighton, and I've got a colleague here who's a policy officer as well. We have been absolutely stunned at the level of disorganization, the lack of communication from National BAME. People have been writing to them for months, and you know, we haven't got the information. We don't know how many ethnic minority women and men are around. It's got to the point where I've decided to network on the grassroots today at the conference, because I'm CLP delegate for Brighton. And I've met so many BAME people saying exactly the same thing, and we cannot do this. I'm a supporter of Momentum, I'm not a member, and I'm really glad to hear as well that there's a Black Caucus. It's the first time I hear about it. Could I ask you a couple of questions? One is, well, obviously we need to change the situation, and on the Latinos for Corbyn Facebook page, I saw the BAME Labour open letter, which maybe some people have heard of, basically bringing up the same points that you've been making. We've signed it, but we can get no information as to who wrote, who originated the letter, who signed the letter, which MPs actually sympathize with what we're trying to do. So it'd be nice to know what's going on with that. And the other thing is, obviously, as a Latino, I'd like to know if the Black Caucus is open to myself.
Thank you.
And if you don't mind, I'll pass my colleague Nelly here as policy officer for
the
Forum.
Thank you.
Can I just add to that, because we're in the same forum?
Yes.
And for 2 years, as policy officer, I've been trying to find who are the main Labour Party members in Brighton Hove.
Okay.
And the issue of that open letter is that it encapsulated everything we've been saying for 2 years, and the membership secretary actually said that the Labour Party doesn't yet collect ethnicity data, and it needs to do that to meet its own Equality Act. It's actually obliged to meet its obligations to survey the membership of its party.
Okay.
And it needs to be intersectional to actually meet the dynamics of what Claudio was talking about. We actually need to know, for example, who are the BAME members who are also disabled, or who are women, or whatever. That is a crucial issue that actually, in a sense, also institutionally racist. It's actually preventing us from reaching out to the BAME membership we know exists in Brighton Hove, because the census in 2011 said it was 20%.
There's been some really there's been so much said. I'm going to keep it as short as I can. When we know what the percentage of ethnic minority is within any area is inexcusable for the Labour Party to have a lower percentage of shortlisted candidates than the percentage of black and ethnic minority within an area. It's a lot easier to argue this, I suggest, than for all black shortlists, and a lot harder to argue against. It may seem like a compromise, but it would be a small step at least in the right direction, and we need to take some steps. Is that something that the people on the panel would support?
Okay, thank you very much for that. Okay, raft of questions here which I'll try and synthesise. Some of the issues already been raised, but there is an issue around data collection and the way in which data can be used to identify and engage Labour Party, BAME Labour Party members. Somebody pointed out that if this is not being done, it's in contravention of the Equality Act 2010. So it's more efficient ways of collecting information that then can be used to engage and involve BAME members. There are two questions that relate to Momentum itself, particularly the National Coordinating Group, and how it is working to engage and involve and resourcing BAME activities, and the efficacy of the BAME caucus within that group in terms of reaching out and engaging, I would have thought, Momentum members more so than Labour Party members or both. So they're the two overriding themes, I think. Kings, I'll start with you.
Well, I picked up one about improving in black councillors so that there are more black councillors. Well, I understand that Momentum NCG is looking into that, and I think Joe Edgefor is leading on that particular one, and he's in the audience at the moment. And NCG can work with Momentum Black Caucus to try and get more black councillors. In years gone by, there used to be a standing convention of black councillors, which disintegrated, and we probably need to go back to working. I'm trying to get more black councillors, but then at the same time, in places like Lambeth, we're trying to get left councillors full stop, as they've all been blocked from getting on the LCF, sorry, the Lambeth Campaign Forum list, because they were something. They signed some petition in support of a left colleague, and they've been barred from the councillors panel. So there's a lot of work for Momentum and others of getting more councillors and black councillors. On Lucy's issues, yes, there should be ethnic monitoring so that we know when people come into Labour, what's their origin, etc. But there's also, you also need to be serious about data protection, and I think Momentum knows about that. The seriousness of making sure that your database is properly done and you don't fall foul of the law. I apologise to those people who've only just found out about Momentum Black Caucus. I will ask John immediately to sign out something on one of the Momentum apps, get in touch with us, we can get in touch with you, where that's concerned. And yes, there needs to be race equality training. There were lots of that in the 70s, 80s, and 90s, and we probably should come back to a bit more of that. Gloria, it's all about self-definition. If you define yourself as BAME, then you're eligible to join. And it's not for me to tell you that you're not BAME, you define yourself. And yes, I've always, as you would expect from the former General Secretary, black sections, I've always supported all black shortlists. And we've actually, in the past, drawn up a list of those seats where we think there should be all black shortlists. And you won't be surprised that Lewisham come right at the top of those seats that we think should be all black shortlists. And we should go back to that.
I think we should first of all make a start with taking up what Kim has suggested. You know, we've obviously got a database. We do actually have quite a lot of information about ethnicity
from more, I think from more kind of, you know, we do have a kind of tick box type of things when you join. That's really about membership, even the members of Momentum. Then we do have some, there is on the Labour Party database which we, and we have information from possibly from leadership campaigns on that originated in the Labour Party database which relates to ethnicity. I think the Labour Party does now collect some data on BAME status, but I think it hasn't got it for very long, and so a lot of members are arguing there's no data, and so not everyone feels anything, it's kind of a luxury, I think. So, but I think very clearly, in order to involve, you know, there needs to be a kind of email which goes out to members of the party to collect information, to encourage people to identify. They have information about gender, right? You know, they have information about age. They don't have information for students, you know, we want to involve students, you need to know where they are. So there's a lot of data that needs to be collected, and that can be done in a concerted, simple way, we've never been doing it. We have always tried to collect the data, but obviously it's easier for members that's Momentum than it is for supporters. So I think we can circulate within Momentum people about Momentum Black Caucus, and I think the BAME caucus on the MCG can also, I think should really meet to consider that as well, so we can take that up. Black councillors, some of our priorities have actually been held back because other things have come to the fore, unfortunately, like general elections and the rather too many leadership elections that we've had, which have kind of been must-do things. Organising for this conference, which is pretty critical because we knew that party reform would become an issue at this, it would be an issue at this conference. We were trying to promote party reform as an issue, and I think it's a great step forward in the right direction that we've got. Obviously, the changes have been recommended by the NEC, but also the party review, which I hope will take things a lot further in all of these issues. I've just lost access to my screen because the phone's ringing. Have I covered everything? I think so.
Claudia, as a member of the NEC, what are you going to do? Sorry.
What you've all discovered is that obviously since we had the court cases in the leadership contest, we learned that actually the Labour Party is no better than a private members club, essentially. And therefore the issues about what governs, for example, public sector bodies like my local authority, having equality monitoring, aren't so readily transparent in a body like the Labour Party. Now, of course, I've asked the question of what do we do in terms of monitoring? And I've received a response which basically says that we do monitoring, equality monitoring. We've always done equality monitoring at the point of people joining the party. And when you ask, well, how many people do we have where we've got data on? We've got 40,000 people where we've got their monitoring data. Well, 40,000 out of almost 600,000 members is obviously quite small. So what we've said and what I've made clear is actually equality monitoring is a continuous exercise. Anybody that works in the public sector or any other institution where it is a requirement, you know that this is a continuous exercise. You aim for 100% monitoring data. So you have a target and you hope to work towards that. So what I've said to the party is, perhaps we can't push you to 100% because we're so far behind. At least set a target maybe of 80%. Target of data, maybe we might get somewhere but the kind of figure that we've got now in terms of monitoring is because we rely on just the joining data and then we do nothing else throughout. So for example, what we should be doing is anybody who comes to this conference, there should be quality monitoring data, and then we keep building it every single time. So it's entirely possible, we just need to educate a little bit in terms of how that is done. I just want to say one thing about BAME Labour, because I didn't really want to talk about BAME Labour, because often we want to put actually the responsibility of some of the inaction that we've had on BAME Labour, when actually BAME Labour is nothing but run by the Labour Party. The Labour Party is responsible for the condition that BAME Labour is currently in, and therefore, under, you know, I said to you very clearly that my purpose of joining the NEC is so that Jeremy has the support that he needs to transform the party. It is not very good, therefore, that we've run an election under Jeremy's leadership that doesn't reflect the kind of ideals that we want. That is the responsibility of the Labour Party, and it's the Labour Party that I hold to account for the failure of BAME Labour to be the kind of transformational body that we want it to be. In actual fact, the party tells me that at the time of the election, there was over 3,000 BAME members. However, only 700 or so were eligible. When we take our fire, we must take our fire to the Labour Party and seek the kind of transformation within the party, which is why the review is important. The review will help to basically deliver the kind of conditions that we want to see in terms of change. But equally, each and every one of us has a responsibility for equality and for race. And therefore, it's not just, John, about BAME organisations on the ground, it's about everybody.
Thank our distinguished panel, Claudia.